No man on earth should give the glory to himself. All the glory must be, all of the glory must be, all the glory must be to the Lord. Take glory, Father. Take glory, Son. Take glory, Holy Spirit. You deserve the praise. Take glory. Take glory, Father. Yes, we praise your name. Take glory, Emmanuel. Take glory, precious Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Almighty God, Almighty God, Almighty God, our generation shall praise your name. Our generation shall praise your name. Our generation shall praise your name. Our generation shall praise your holy name. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we exalt you. We come before your throne. You are our Abba. We take absolute control and authority over the atmosphere in your name. We ask that you will take preeminence. We ask that your angels will surround us. We pray that this recording will be clear so that you will bless humanity world over. We thank you because we know you're already here with us. And we give you praise because, Lord, everything that I will speak today will not be of my own self, but Holy Spirit, you fill my mouth. And every hearer will be blessed and our lives will be better for it. And the kingdom will grow. The kingdom, the body of Christ will be edified. Daddy, we exalt your name because this teaching, this recording will be a posterity for your glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. How is your weekend going? How are you doing? How is your family? I trust everyone is well. Thank God we're on the seventh class. Oh, wow. This is a very, will I say, tenacious group. I celebrate every single one of you, especially the parents who are there with their children. It's amazing. God bless you. Thank you so much. You make it worth it. Amen. You make this work worth it for me. It's exciting to come here. I find that people are really excited to learn more and they are here to honor God. It's good because some people will call for a class and there will be nobody there. Praise God. So we're all in our notes. I see some people are viewing already. That's good. All right. So today we are looking at module 2, lesson 7. God has really helped us. And today's topic is stewardship 102. It's all part of stewardship. So stewardship is broken into three parts. The first part is what we studied yesterday, kingdom service. That's stewardship 101. Today is the part two of stewardship, authority and submission. And the third part of it is financial stewardship, which I said people don't like to talk about, and we're going to talk about it anyway. So our memory verse for today is Hebrews 13:17. I know we mentioned it yesterday. Also, Romans 13 is so interesting that sometimes God just uses numbers to say the same messages. And we're going to see a theme of that tonight. We're going to see numbers, number play. I'll say number play. So you see Hebrews 13, Romans 13. When we're talking about the fall of Lucifer, you see also Revelation 12. And the same thing you see, Revelation 14, 12 to 17. It's interesting. So they're just connections in those numbers. So let's quickly read our memory verse, Hebrews 13, 17. It says, obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that will be unprofitable for you. It's very interesting that we are looking at this scripture in depth today, because we talked about it briefly in our Q&A, I believe, yesterday. So the Bible implores us to submit to authority. So authority and submission is not something that is made up by man. It is actually the word of God. Without authority and submission, you will not have an effective organization, any organization at all, any organization at all. It's just that sometimes when we come to church, culture comes to bear. So if you have more Nigerians in the church, you see the emphasis on submission and respect. If you go to an American church, there's submission and the authority there, but it plays out differently in different cultures. But believe me, authority and submission is expected in every organization, whether it's a church or outside the church. There must be someone in charge. Leadership is important. So if we're to give this thing another name, it's leadership 101. But it's a basic, so we're just learning about authority and submitting to authority. So it's the two sides of the same coin, all right? So it talks about order. Someone must be in charge. Every time you see God start a roll out a dispensation, there's always an anchor man, a lead role there. In the time of Abraham, Abraham was the lead role. In the time of Joseph, in the time of Moses, in the time of Joshua, in the time of Peter, in the time of Jesus, John the Baptist, there will always be a lead role. There will always be a man to defer to. And so to make work easier for this person, that's why the Bible is saying, obey those who have rule over you, be submissive to them. They watch over your soul. They will give reports. Like I said yesterday, Hebrews 9:27. Says it is appointed unto man once to die and after that the judgment. And the Bible says it clearly that we will give account. The parable of the talent said that we must give account. It is an inevitability. So our Bible reading from today is from Romans chapter 13 from verse 1 to 7. Let's read quickly. We have so many reads today. I want us to touch on the point that we need to touch on, and some will go and read on our own. The original didn't have all the scriptures, but I felt it would be easier instead of you opening scriptures to just read it on the same page. I think you agree with me. Amen. So let's quickly read Romans 13, 1 to 7. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. Do you see? It says, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. And those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good work, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of the authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For it is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Therefore, you must be subject, not only because of God's wrath, but also for conscience sake. Verse 6, for because of this, you also pay taxes. For they are God's ministers, attending continually to this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, taxes to whom taxes are due, customs to whom customs are due, fear to whom fear is due, honor to whom honor is due. Why is it that people find it difficult to give honor? It's so interesting. People find it difficult, whether you're from one culture or the other. I've noticed this, especially in the African culture, is a big deal. I pray that the Lord will minister to us. So there's a place where we'll draw a line between our cultural or ethnic idiosyncrasies, or what will I say, our cultural beliefs. And then we'll also draw the line between the scriptural beliefs or doctrines. But in the Bible, you will see honor play out when it comes to ministry, when it comes to unction and functions of ministry, when it comes to prophetic mantle, when it comes to even healing, virtue, when it comes to prophetic word. The Bible said, believe in the Lord your God, you'll be established, believe also his prophets, and you will prosper. Jesus Christ could not do many miracles in Nazareth because they took him for granted. But that's another story for another day. Now we're talking about leadership and the people that is being led. So a Bible text, we're going to look at two different texts, one for submission and one for authority. Like I told you, we have a lot of grace today, and the Lord grant us speed. So the first one for submission, please pay attention to it. Philippians 2, 1 to 16 is talking about Jesus Christ, how he submitted to the will of God and the plan of God. If you are really a child of God and you have the Spirit of Christ in you, submission will be easy. Submission to authority, regardless of your secular status or power or wealth, when you come into the church, you submit. Regardless of your age, you will submit, because this is the ordinance of God. Let's quickly read. Therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ, if there be any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. So submission is about being of unity, of one accord. Amen. Regardless of who is in charge, whether the person is educated or non-educated like Peter, whether the person is old like Moses, because Moses was 80, you know, or whether the person is young like Joshua, it doesn't matter. By the time Joshua took over, though, he was already 80 years old. But as a young man, you know, or whether the person is young like Jesus Christ, who was only 30, or David, who was 30 when he ruled, or much younger when he was anointed as king, or Joseph, who was, you know, 30 when he became the primate of Egypt. You know, whether the person is young or old, or Timothy that Paul said, do not let anyone despise your youth. Instead, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. So whether you are the leader or the one submitted to the leader, he's saying, do not be conceited, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each one of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bond servant, and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to the death of the cross. Jesus Christ humbled himself to the death of the cross. Can you imagine? Therefore, God has highly exalted him. This is the key to his lifting. He submitted himself. He humbled himself. He became obedient to the point of death. He offered his life like a sheep that is led to the slaughter. He literally died for you and I. And the Bible says that because he made himself humbled, because he obeyed to the point of death, even the death of the cross, therefore, God has highly exalted him. The name of Jesus is higher than every other name. In the Holy Trinity, the name of Jesus is the highest. That name breaks open doors. That name shake the kingdom of darkness. That name break loose the gates of Sheol. That name opens the windows of heaven to us. That name opens the doors of heaven, open the hallways of heaven to us. That name, by that name, the everlasting doors are lifted up. That name is powerful. That name heals the sick. That name raises the dead. That name is exalted in heaven and on earth. He said, therefore, also God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every other name. That the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of those in heaven, on earth, and those under the earth. Remember, I said that hell is down. Everything in hell bows before this name. Demons, principalities, and powers in the heavenly realm bow before this name. He said, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, so it's not for high service, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Do all things without complaining and disputing. Do you see that? I highlighted that. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God, without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I may not run in vain or labor in vain. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Also, you will see there are two concepts here. The first one is authority, and the second one is submission. So authority is the power to govern. Submission is the ability to yield. So in whatever office you find yourself as a believer, you will either be submitting to authority above you, you'll be submitting, submission, or you'll be governing. So there will always be a time. For example, even if there's a general overseer, you see there are several general overseers or the apostolic leader of ministries, they must of essence submit to God. Okay, they must submit to the Godhead. They must submit to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And when they are leading, they must also submit to other authorities. Sometimes they will have a mentor, they will have a pastor, they will have an elder, somebody who they defer to. It's very dangerous not to have somebody like that in your life who can correct you. So there will be authority, whether the person is the lead role of the ministry or not. For example, there are people that I answer to contemporary-wise, and then people that serve as a covering over me in ministry, and people that I cover by the grace of God, or I lead. So there will always be that level where you must submit to. And then authority is the power to govern, is the power to lead. Amen. And is ordained by God, as we can see from the scripture. Authority can be constituted or delegated. So there's constituted authority. Look at the government of our nation. The Bible says we should submit to all the powers, the authorities that are in place, the constituted authority of the United States of America, the constituted authority of the state of Georgia, Gwinnett County. There are some hierarchies that are put in place in government. The same thing in the church. There are apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers. There are hierarchies, there are levels of authorities, you know, and the considered authority, the Bible says, is ordained by God. Look at it in Romans chapter 13. It says it's ordained by God. 1 Timothy chapter 2 shows that God is the source of all authority. God is a stickler for order. If there's anything you should know about God today, God is a stickler for order. He puts order in place. You will see even God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the Godhead. There is hierarchy. The Holy Spirit defers to Jesus. Jesus defers to the Father. Not because they are less, but because that is the order of God. Amen. 1 Timothy 2:2 says, for kings are not those who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life. He said we should pray. If you read 1 Timothy chapter 2 from verse 1, he said we should live so that we shall lead a peaceable life in godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Submission to authority is not a function of age or status. Peter submitted to Christ despite his physical age. Peter was much more older than Jesus, but he submitted to Jesus Christ. Mark 10:28, the Bible said, then Peter began to say to him, see, we have left all to follow you. So Jesus answered and said, that surely I say to you, there is no one who has left house, brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children and land for my sake or for the gospel's sake. So Peter left all to follow Jesus Christ. Our goal as believers is to simply serve the Lord and his people in true humility. We must do it in true humility. A true Christian must understand the place of authority and submission, like the centurion in Matthew chapter 8, verse 9. You will see that this man said, I'm a man under authority, and I have so many soldiers under me. So you must understand the play of authority. You being the person in authority, you must understand authority and how to exercise it. And then you must also understand submission. So in our life, there will always be a time where we're in a lead role. For example, father is the authority in the house. The mother is the next in hierarchy, and then the children. Amen. And for some special situations where we have one parent, the parent there is the authority. Amen. And so the authority is constituted by God. Authority is interesting because that authority must also give submission, must yield to God. And that is the example we give in the family. How much more, you know, in workplaces or in the church setting. And so in this situation, we are really talking about the church. So this man, this centurion, told Jesus Christ that he shouldn't come to his house, that he believes that when he says a word, it will come to pass. He said, I'm a man under authority. I'm a manager. And I also have soldiers under me. So he understood that place very well. He said, I say to one, come. And I say to the other, do this. And he does that. So Jesus described the centurion's faith as being great. He understood authority and submission. For you to excel in kingdom service, for you to please the Father, you must understand the place of authority and submission. It takes faith to submit. You must be ready to serve in both capacity as a believer in the kingdom, because there will be times when leadership will fall on your laps. Somebody can quit, somebody can walk out, somebody can graduate to glory, somebody can move to a new town, the pastor can hand over the church to you when he travels. So you must be ready to operate in the place of leadership, but it's not because you want to enforce or you want to exert authority, is because you are fulfilling a role. We must understand that it is a necessity in the kingdom. It's a necessary role to fulfill. So you must understand authority and submit to authority. And you must know how to be, you know, the leader who submits to God. So we always need to, you know, understand this, to operate in both capacity. Without reservation, You must learn it. In whatever role you serve, you must imbibe the heart of a servant. Whether you are the lead pastor, the general overseer, the founder, the governor, the prophet, whatever title or leadership role, the head of department, the head of the choir, the zonal coordinator, whatever role you play, you must do it with the heart of a servant. Jesus exemplified this concept many times in his ministry and his lifestyle. In John chapter 13, verse 14, he said, "If I then be your Lord and teacher, I've washed your feet." He was talking about the feet washing and what it means, what it represents. He said, "You also ought to wash one another's feet. For I've given you an example that you should also do as I have done. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." So Jesus Christ is saying, though you are the lead role, though you are the head of department, though you are the minister in charge of all the ministries in your church, you must do it with humility. You must do it as a servant. Jesus Christ said that the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. He came to lay his life down. Can you lay your life down for your department? Can you put your needs aside and see to the needs of your department? Can you see to the needs of your ministry? Can you put your own selfish needs aside and start to minister to others? That's what Jesus Christ is saying. He put aside all his garb. He took off his robe. He wrapped himself with a towel and he began to wash their feet. He put his outer robe off. He started to wash their feet. He put off the title. He put off the, you know, whatever reputation, whatever accolades, he put it aside and he began to wash their feet. In the time of Jesus Christ, feet washing is one of the lowest jobs of the servants. They reserve it for the lowest ranking slaves or servants. So when people come, because they live in the desert and they wear sandals and it's always very dusty, so when they come into the house, especially the house of rich men like Simon the leper, remember, you know, at Bethany, you know, the house of Lazarus, all of those people, they will make sure that they wash the feet so that people, when they lay at the table to eat, they will, their feet, because they lived, you know, before they moved to the land of Canaan, they were nomadic people and they lived in tents and all of those things. So that was their culture. When they came in, when the first person to come in, they will wash the person's feet and towel the person's feet. And that was why Jesus Christ gave, you know, praise to the woman with the alabaster box, which is also the sister of John Lazarus, by the way. She said she has not stopped cleaning my feet, wiping my feet with her hair and washing it with her tears. That is the culture of the day, to honor someone coming in. And so Jesus Christ became the servant. And if you read the whole chapter, Peter said, "Don't wash me. Ah, master, that's an insult. You shouldn't." And he said, "No, if I don't wash you, you have no part in me. Because you don't understand the way this kingdom works. The kingdom of this kingdom I'm introducing to you is different from the kingdom of the world. The kingdom of the world is that the Gentiles, those who have leadership or rulership, they lord it over their followers." He said, "But not in this kingdom. In this kingdom, I serve. I have come to serve. And whoever must be the greatest among you, whoever must be the apostle, the pastor, the preacher, the evangelist, whoever must be the leader, must be the servant, must be the slave." That's the mentality we must bring in here, whether you are the head of department or you are the member of the department. So whether you are the leader or the worker, you must understand the authority and submission. And the authority is to God. When you are submitted to the constituted authority or the delegated authority, you are in essence saying, "I know God is here and I'm submitted to the leadership." You are not going to be fighting the leadership. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5, he said, "Bond servants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh." Remember, I gave example and I was illustrating with slaves and bond servants. Bond servants are, you know, they are bonded to their masters. They are servants. They are not slaves. They decide to stay after they've been released. He said, "Serve your masters according to the flesh with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart, as to Christ, not with eye service or men pleasers." So we're not supposed to be men pleasers, but as bond servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will, doing service as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord. So when you are serving in that department, in the choir, in the ushering department, the prayer team, you are serving, you are doing it as unto the Lord. He said, whether he's a slave, whether he's a slave or free, and you masters do the same to them. See, he's saying the same thing to the masters, giving up threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven. There's no partiality with him. So regardless of the master, of the servants. We all defer to God. And so when we serve, we must do it as unto the Lord. So what does submission mean? Submission is the ability to yield to authority. The Bible describes divine wisdom as the ability to yield, easily entreated, is teachable, is without hypocrisy, without partiality, is not strong-headed. That's true wisdom. But sensual wisdom, earthly wisdom is like, you know what? They have to know. I have to put my name out there. You know, I remember when I worked in one of the offices in Chicago, my boss would call me and say, yeah, you need to make your impact known. You need to, you see, one of the ways to leverage, you know, what you're doing is to make sure that your name is on all the documents on the shared drive. So what my colleagues used to do then is that even when we do a collaboration on any project, they'll make sure, I had no idea that was what they were doing, but they will make sure that, Raeni, send me the document, send me what you've worked on, I'll compile it, so that when they go on the shared drive, it says the author of the document and is reading their name. So when they want to see who is doing what and who is not doing what, on the shared drive, it's showing the author of the document is that particular person. And they will do this so many times. Yeah, very sneaky. That's exactly what they were doing. And I had no clue. I would just put in my own bit and I will withdraw. But I give God praise because the God in heaven, who is the judge of all, sometimes he will defend you. And there will be times when we're in the meeting and they're asking questions and the other people who didn't do the work cannot answer. They just put their name on the document. And I would do the work, I'll be able to answer. And everybody would just be like amazed and surprised. I remember then my boss would call me because he really liked me. And he would be like, hey, Raeni, you're not aggressive enough. I need you to be aggressive. They're saying, be pushy, be aggressive, walk over everybody, do it, grab it. And I'm not for power grabs, you know, because of some of the things that we've learned in church. I know that servant leadership is a very difficult concept to operate with in the secular, but I pray that the Lord will give you wisdom. The Bible said we should be gentle as doves and wise as serpents. Honestly, I didn't have a clue then. But now when I bring it into ministry, I see that the way leadership is portrayed in the secular is different from the way leadership is in the kingdom. In the kingdom, nobody takes credit for anything. All the credit belongs to God. Amen. Yes, it does. It does. Amen. And I think during our Q&A session, we'll be able to discuss some of these things and how to strike a balance. Honestly, it's just a wicked world out there. The Bible calls it a wicked and perverse generation, believe me. Amen. But you know, in the kingdom, it's different. In the kingdom, we do it. Sometimes someone will put in 80%. The other person can only put in 20% in every area, in time, in treasure, and in talent. As much as I want to sing, I can't sing like some anointed. God really gave them the voice. And so when it comes to worship, even though I'm a worshiper, I would defer to those God has given that grace. Amen. And so when it comes to worship, some people may give 80% and I can only give my 20%. But in my personal space, I give my 150%, believe me. Amen. The same thing with giving. Some people are more, they have the capacity. You know, I'm 100 naira or 1,000 naira in dollars. Some people are in the hundreds of thousands in dollars. Some people are in the millions in dollars. So when we come to church, my tithe is not going to be the same as somebody who is a millionaire. It would be unfair to do that. So we all give according to the grace that has been given to us. The same thing with time. Somebody who is working maybe 12-hour shifts on a weekly basis, maybe 4 or 5 times a week, compared to somebody who does 9-to-5, compared to somebody who works, you know, from the house. We all can give different things in capacity in the kingdom. And so this is where we must be able to strike a balance. Whatever we do, whether in words or in deeds, should be done unto the Lord, as unto the Lord. So because you are giving $1 million in tithe and someone is giving $10 in tithe, doesn't make you better than them, if you get what I mean. So we are just yielding to God. Is the ability to submit and putting everything in God's. Submission simply means obeying and putting God's will above ours. It's not doing what we want to do, but complying to his precepts in every area, in every situation. We should be able to look at it in the three dimensions of talent, time, treasure, and say, am I submitting in every area? Am I submitting to God? Am I submitting to authority? Amen. And then also in working, sometimes some people can do more. Some people can be there in the ushering department. They can be there, you know, quicker than others. The example I gave of a woman who has a baby, a newborn, and compared to someone who has older children, they can, and some people's children can even drive them to church while they're getting ready or doing stuff, you know. So we all have different capacity, but we must have this understanding that the submission is unto the Lord. The service is unto the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, godly authority can be seen in different areas. It can be seen in the nation. We see our law and taxes. And from the scripture we read earlier, I said, we should give honor to whom honor. We should give custom to whom custom, dues to whom dues. Please do not cut corners. Do not evade taxes. Don't. Those people who used to paint their tax documents with lies, don't. The Bible said that the lake of fire is prepared for all those who live and make it a lie. Do not. It's not. It's, we are preparing for heaven. We are looking on to his appearing. Please do not. Do not escape excise duty, customs that you have to pay at the point of entry. Don't lie on these documents, please. Don't. Also, authority, godly authority can be seen in the church, like we've been talking about since yesterday. Servant leadership is the concept of our own leadership. It's different from the dog-eat-dog world that surrounds us. The same thing in the home. I gave the example of the father, the mother, also husband, wife, then children. In the traditional family, we have all kinds of situations going on now, but usually the parent is the leader. And if the parents are absent and the siblings are all living together, the older sibling, by the grace of God, is the leader, especially if they are saved. Amen. And then work. We have to obey our employers and our bosses. That's what we just read in Ephesians 6. It said, bond servant, be obedient to your masters. And in the school, we have the teachers, the administrators, and all that. And so there's always authority all around us. It's not just in the church setting. It's just that today we are looking at it just so that our kingdom service becomes easier for us, not only as leaders, but as somebody who is submitted to authority, whether we're submitted to the board of pastors, submitted to the board of deacons, submitted to the board of women leaders, or to the zonal coordinator. Don't make it difficult for them. We give reports and they will give reports about us. And I've asked yesterday if they are to give reports about you, what will they say? So this should be the question in our hearts when we're looking at authority and submission. So ability to govern, ability to exercise power or authority, that is the definition of authority. When we resist authority or defy the ordinances of the land, we are resisting God and it incurs divine judgments. Romans chapter 13 verse 1 says, let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. All authorities are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. And those who resist it will bring judgment on themselves. I didn't say it, the scripture says it. It invites divine judgment. And we're going to see some examples before we close. Amen. So we are instructed to obey all authority, except when such authority is against the word of God. When those instructions, the law of the land is against the word of God. So some lands permits, you know, all kind of marriages now. Some laws permit all kind of things. Some countries have permitted all kind of daring things, pedophilia and all that. I'm sure some parents know what I'm talking about. And it excuses people from doing, to do evil, to express their depravity to the core. Now, that's not what I'm talking about here. We are talking about authority that is godly, is righteous. Amen. We are instructed to obey all authority except where it's in conflict with God's word. We are mandated to obey the word of God. So when the law of the land is contrary to the will of God or the word of God, then we obey God's word. At that point, we are allowed to disobey the law of the land. A good example is in Daniel 6, when they said they shouldn't pray to any other God, knowing that they wanted to trap Daniel. And what did Daniel do? Daniel broke that law. He prayed to God. He went to the lion's den. And guess what? The God he served delivered him from the lion's den. Was that not so? Is that not the case? And so in the case where you have to judge between God's law and the law of the land, then go with God's law. Amen. But ordinarily, we're supposed to obey the law of the land. Pay your taxes. Do not overspeed. Do not steal, do not break ranks, so many other things. The land, the laws of the land in general, we're supposed to obey the laws of the land. And so Jesus Christ demonstrated the combination of power and authority. He also gave his disciples power and authority. You can read it in Luke chapter 9, verse 10, Luke chapter 10, verse 19. He said, power and authority I've given to you, and you have power over all the works of the devil, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Matthew 28:19, he said, all power and authority has been given to me. So all power and authority has been given to Jesus Christ, and he gave the same to us. The Bible also says the same in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 21. He has made us rulers over principalities and powers because we are in him. Because we are in him, we have his authority. So right now, despite the fact that we obey the rules of the land and the government, we still rule in the realm of the spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, we can rule. So there is a place for you to temper authority. Spiritually, you can exercise authority. On your knees, you can exercise authority, especially when the constitution of the land is contrary to that of God. Amen. But in a day-to-day power play, when you're at work, when you're at school, you must defer to the teacher. Let the lecturer be the lecturer. Do not try to prove a point. In your class, in your department, at church, the pastor, the deacons, the elders, the ministers, they are in charge. Let them lead and then you follow. If you have a suggestion, there must be a way of going through the chains of command. We must not break rank. Amen. So why submit to authority? The Bible says for conscience sake, we must submit to be more like Christ. Remember, we read Philippians 2, 6 to 11, where Jesus Christ submitted to authority. The Bible said, wherefore God has highly exalted him. Why? Because of the fact that he gave his life. He submitted himself. He went like a sheep to the slaughter. The Bible said he laid his life down. And we always praise him as the Lamb of God, the precious Lamb of God. Even in heaven, the Bible still describes him in the vision that John saw as the Lamb that was slain. And he's the one that has the power to open the seal and break open. You know, he's the only one in heaven and earth. God gave him that honor. Why? Because he honored his Father by dying for mankind. Amen. And we must submit to one another. We must submit in obedience to God. We must submit to release unction. And I will explain that later. You see lower in the notes, I say unction flows in the direction of honor. The Bible says he who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. The opposite of submission is rebellion. And we'll see that in 1 Samuel chapter 15. It says rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. The Bible says suffer not a witch to live. God hates rebellion so much. He hates pride. The first iniquity that was ever recorded in the Bible of sin is that of Lucifer. And we'll look at it quickly. God hates rebellion. God despises it. It's like the sin of witchcraft. Stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. He said, because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king. These were the words of Samuel to Saul. And we'll look at the case study if time permits. I'm looking at time so that we can cover all the relevant material. The opposite of submission is rebellion. So please make sure that in your heart, you're not rebellious. I've heard my pastor give an example in the past where he said that, you know, sometimes their father would tell them to sit down. But his brother would say, yes, I'm sitting down, but in my mind, I'm standing. You understand? That is rebellion. That was a good picture of rebellion where you obey the person just so that you don't get whooped. But in your heart, you are really rebellious. Many of us, I've done it, you've done it, and many of us have done it in the past where you just sit down and say, okay, you want me to sit down, I will obey you. But in your heart, you know that you're not going to obey the rules. You know, so we should check our hearts, we should check our motives when it comes to authority and submission. Amen. May the Lord give us grace. I know that we have tough leaders, we have sometimes ungodly pastors, but 80 to 90%, we have okay pastors. And we can still submit. Amen. We can learn to do it. Amen. The flesh does not want to submit, by the way. Satan was the originator of rebellion when he wanted to be like God. He waged war against God and he lost and was cast down from God's presence. You will see this in Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12 to 14, the fall of Lucifer. Please read it in your spare time. It talks about how Lucifer fell from heaven and he said that he was brought down to Sheol, to the lowest part of the pit. And so when you look at Sheol or the pit, it's talking about hell. And those who see you, he said they will gaze at you and consider you, saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble? Is this the one who shook kingdom? Because God made him small. He's no longer that glorified cherubim. God reduced him to nothing. But because the callings of God are without repentance, the Bible says he's still a shapeshifter. That means he can transform to an angel of light. He does whatever he wants with the images that were given to him before, but he has lost it. He's the lowest being ever. Remember the serpent in the garden. That's just what Satan is. And God has given us authority to trample over him. Amen. And then in Revelation chapter 12, verse 7, it gives us the reason why he is cast down to the earth. In Matthew chapter, in Revelation chapter 12, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. But Revelation chapter 12, verse 7 to 12 is where he said war broke out in heaven. It's the same thing, the same discourse. Isaiah saw one part of the vision, Revelation, that's the John, the revelation by Apostle John or Prophet John is the same thing. He saw war break out in heaven. Why? Because of Satan's rebellion. So Satan is also called the dragon. And that's why I always beg mothers, please don't buy clothes that has dragon logo on your children or design. If you've bought it in the past, don't do it anymore. Will you go and buy things that they drew serpent on for yourself or your children? Don't buy those things. I avoid it so much. Dragon is also called Satan. He's also called the serpent of old, the devil. He's the one that fought against Archangel Michael. And the Bible said that there was war. This war, it led to the descent of angels, the fallen angels. So a third, the Bible refers to angels as stars sometimes. So if you read this discourse, it said that a third of the stars were dragged with the tail of the dragon. He's talking about a third of the angels that fell with him. So some people call fallen angels demons. Fallen angels are not demons. If you come to our prophetic school, I will explain it better for you when we deal with spiritual warfare. Fallen angels are not demons, and demons are not fallen angels. Demons love to inhabit people. Fallen angels like to lord it over places, like the prince of Persia. They are princes. They are principalities. So when you see principalities and powers, those are fallen angels. But when you see demons, they are small. They are the children of women and angels from Genesis 6. It's beyond the scope of this class, by the way. But the rebellion of Satan fed into the rebellion of man. So when Satan was cast down, let's quickly read from verse 10. It said, then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Lord and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of the brethren, that's also Satan, as Satan, is our accuser, who accused them before God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimony. And they did not love their life unto the death. Therefore, rejoice, O heaven, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea. For the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows his time is short. So because he's cast down to earth, that's why the earth is in so much turmoil. That's why the earth is in so much pandemonium. He was cast out from heaven. Heaven was his original abode. So go and read it and you will understand it. Isaiah chapter 14. And then Ezekiel also talks about it. I think it's Ezekiel 28, talking about the prince of Tyre and the king of Tyre. He's talking about Satan, by the way. Okay, so the rebellion of man, we've read it in Genesis chapter 3 when we talked about salvation. So if you want to remind yourself of this fall, go back and listen to the recording or go through the note for salvation. And you will see in Genesis chapter 3, the serpent pretended to be someone he was not, and he fooled Eve, and Eve gave the fruits of the tree that they were not supposed to eat to Adam, and they lost their glory. They fell. So that was what led to the fall of man, and that was how sin came into the world. And so rebellion is very dangerous. What happened with Satan was that he wanted to be like God, and so he started to manifest pride. And God brought him down. And that was what caused the war in heaven. And now when he came to the earth, he saw that man has been put in charge of the earth and he wanted to rule. So remember that the devil calls himself the prince of the power of the air or the prince of this age. He got that title by treason, by fooling and cheating man. That's why John 10:10 says that the thief is the thief. When the Bible is talking about the thief, it's talking about Satan. The thief comes to steal, to kill, to destroy. But I am that I am. Jesus Christ said, I am come, that they will have life and life, have it more abundantly. And so if we are to have the mind of Christ, we will submit to the Father like he submitted in Philippians 2 from verse 1 to the end. But those who are rebellious, they are seen as the children of disobedience, the children of Satan. So it always brings divine judgment. You must understand this. Anytime rebellion comes to play, God judges it seriously. Rebellion is dangerous. anybody who has this independent spirit in ministry is very dangerous. When the person is a loner, they want to do things by themselves, they don't submit to any authority, it's dangerous. How can you be by yourself? How can you not have nobody to defer to? It's a dangerous place to be. You need someone to correct, you need someone to instruct, you need someone to be with, you need someone. Even Paul, as much as he called himself the least of the apostles, because when he was alive, he chose to defer to the authority in Jerusalem. Jerusalem was where the headquarters of the church was. And you see that he talks about the pillars of faith in Jerusalem, like James and John and Peter. He saw them as his leaders, despite the fact that in Revelation, he was way above many of them. But he chose to submit. So you must choose. This is a choice. You cannot have an independent spirit. I'm a lone ranger. God did not create man to be lone ranger. Remember when Adam was by himself? He was miserable. And God brought Eve his way. And then they related with God. Amen? So, as believers, we're instructed to submit to authority, not work in our own self-desire, no matter how honorable they may seem. Nadab and Abihu acted presumptuously against God's instruction. You can read it in Leviticus 10 and Exodus 30. They called down strange fire, and because of that, God killed them. You must not have any strange altar. You must not break ranks. They broke the rank. Aaron was still alive. Moses was still alive, and they were doing their own thing. So when pastor calls a meeting, you're also calling your meeting. When pastor gives an instruction, you're also giving your instruction. It's very dangerous. Very dangerous. Same thing with murmuring and complaining. Remember Dathan, Korah, and Abiram in Numbers chapter 16 from verse 1 to the end. Encourage you to go and read it. We don't have time to read it today, but go and read it. These people were actually the cousins they were actually Levites. Korah was a Korahite from the house of Levi. So they were the leaders, they were the priests, they were the ones that were carrying all the, you know, instruments that they used to build the tabernacle. You know, they moved from camp to camp and they would dismantle the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, and they would assemble it. You need to go and read the book of Leviticus, guys. It's very interesting. Leviticus, Exodus, and Numbers. They would dismantle it, they would assemble it, they would dismantle it all through the time of Samuel, all through the time of David, where David went to bring the Ark of the Covenant. So that was what they were doing. They would assemble and disassemble it. And so David was like, the reason why God loved David so much was like, why is God living in a tent and I'm living in a real house? I must build God a house. And God said, your hand is so bloody, man. I want your son to build the house. And so that is why God loved David so much. So this tabernacle started with Moses. Okay, so Korah was one of his cousins in the house of Levi. They were one of the people who actually built, you know, and carried those things, the tent of meeting, where God dwells, his presence with them in Israel. And Korah was like, who made you and Aaron lord over us? Why are you the ones in the front? Why can't we be the one? Why are we the kings and you guys are pastors? Who made you prophets and we cannot be? You know, I don't know if you've read that before. That's exactly what happened in Numbers 16. And the Lord said, if I have not called you, then these people will die a natural death. In verse 28 and 29, just as Moses finished speaking these words like this, the ground opened up and swallowed them up. So murmuring and complaining against delegated authority is dangerous, especially when the authority is in place. Now, the truth is this. How are we going to know whether God is the one that ordained the person or God didn't call them? So you do not want to touch God's anointed. And this I say very carefully, because some people say, so when pastor is operating in sin or operating with impunity or doing everything, disregarding all the laws of God, then the Bible said, by their fruits you shall know them. I would encourage you to separate yourself from such a pastor who sins with impunity, who does things, you know, openly disregarding the laws of God, like Hophni and Phinehas, the sons of Eli. Okay? Even Samuel, he found himself in that situation. Look at, he found himself in that house. He didn't have a perfect master, but he submitted himself to, because the priesthood must be perpetuated through the generations. And so because Samuel was the innocent child there, guess what? The mantle passed from Eli, skipped Hophni and Phinehas, and went to the little boy. The boy that was covenanted by his mother, because the mother must have seen all the atrocities being committed in the temple at the time. And she said, you know what, God, you need a prophet, a true prophet. This is a mess. But Lord, I need a son. If you give me a son, I'll bring you a prophet. And that was, the door was sealed. The deal was sealed. The deed was done. And God gave her a son and she brought him back in the midst of that corruption. So even in that, your corrupt church, they're still good. Amen. God is still the orchestrator of righteousness. And he brought Samuel. When Samuel was giving his valedictory speech, he said, whose ram have I stolen? Whose gold did I steal? Who did I defraud amongst you? He had an impeccable testimony. And that is how we should be. Even in the midst of chaos, even in that prayerless church, you should be the prayer warrior, the intercessor there. Even in the midst of that unrighteous generation, you should be the righteous. When God is looking all around, let him find you as the Job. Let him find you as the Daniel. Let him find you as the Noah in your generation. Amen. In that church, except the Lord tells you to leave, or is outrightly an altar of demons. If that altar is the altar, you see that they started to call other names and do other things there, then leave. I tell you, leave. We don't even need to pray. Pack your load and run. But if they are still calling on the name of Jesus and it's just a character issue, you may just be there to pray for the efficacy of God's word. And when it's time, the Lord will duly, in due season, will separate you. He said, do not be weary in doing good. For in due season, the Lord will exalt you. He will promote you. He will give you your rewards. Amen. Now, you see the example of David and Saul. David came to Saul and stood before him, and he loved him greatly, and he became his armor bearer. But you see that later, he turned against him. Sometimes the people who should mentor you, they become your enemy. Sometimes some leaders are threatened by your anointing. Sometimes they are intimidated by your grace. Some people don't know how to handle it. And some people, I don't know, they just hate your God. They will refuse to mentor you. Don't be angry. God will raise others. God will raise others that will help you. And if you find yourself in a bitter situation, if you think you need counseling or a personal time, reach out to me and we can talk about it, because I've seen some very painful situations. So it might not fit the general mold. It may not fit the general mold. But if you're in a bad situation, an abusive pastor member or pastor leader situation, feel free to reach out to me. But usually, you may just be building your own character. It might be showing you how not to lead. There are times when I've been part of different ministries over the years, from campus through now. I'll say over the span of about 30 years, I've been part of different ministry groups and all. And I've learned how to lead in some churches. I've learned how not to lead. I'm currently attending an American church that there's subtle racism, and I'm sure they are clueless about it, you know. But I've decided to take the best, because there's a journey I'm walking and God is taking me somewhere. And so God wants me to learn. He's teaching me how to do ministry and how not to do ministry. So if you are patient enough, you won't need to be church hopping. You will find out what you came to learn there. And the day you learn it, believe me, that's the day you'll be promoted out of that class. Hallelujah. It is dangerous to run God's purpose and divine intent with our own method. It's very dangerous. When we try to walk with God's plan, with our own ideas, we run into trouble. Imagine if David took the Lord into his hand and killed Saul. Do you know that men like Joab and Abishai, they'd be cut off his head in the twinkle of an eye? They won't even think. But because he refused to kill his own masters, Joab could not touch him. Go and study David. Because if I start the story of Joab and David, we won't leave this place. Joab was the one that helped them to kill Uriah, by the way. But Joab was also the one that turned against him when his son Absalom wanted to steal the throne from him. His trusted ally became his enemy. Do not be a Joab. And do not put your life in anybody's hand. Or too much of David's nonsense was in Joab's hand. So Joab was like, who made him king? We will finish him here. And God is saying, you will finish who? I am his God. I am his master. I am his deliverer. And God defended David. Amen. Praise the Lord. David died of a broken heart because of his son and because of the betrayal that he experienced from his generals. It's a very painful thing. But I want to give us two examples here, two case studies, Samuel and Saul. In 1 Samuel 15, remember in verse 23, where he said that, you know, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fattings of ram. He said that disobedience is like the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness or rebellion is like idolatry. God hates it so much with a passion. So what happened there? They were supposed to go to war, and they were supposed to go to the war with the Amalekites. The Amalekites are one of the enemy nations of Israel, and they were supposed to kill everything because Amalekites served the devil, and sometimes they've done all kinds of things with their animals, with their humans and all that. And God is saying, do not bring any of their animals. Kill everything. Just like he did in Jericho, kill everything. And Saul retained some of those things. And the man of God said, what am I hearing? Am I hearing the bleat of sheep and goats in my ears? What do I hear? He said, we kept them for the sacrifice of the Lord. He said, who told you to keep it? Please go and read it. Because of time, we'll not be able to read the scripture. Or maybe we have about 20 something minutes. Let me see. We should be able to read this one so that we can learn a lesson from it. I know it already. I don't want to gloss over it. Let's read this case study. I think it will pay us. We will learn something from it. Saul and Samuel. Let's read it. 1 Samuel 15:10. Now the word of the Lord came to Samuel saying, I greatly regret that I have set up Saul as king. May God never see that concerning any of us. He said, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And he grieved Samuel. Samuel was the one that ordained Saul, and he loved him so much like a son. He said he grieved him and he cried out to the Lord all night. So when Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, it was through Samuel saying, Saul went to Carmel, and indeed he set up a monument for himself. And he was gone on around, passing by and gone to Gilgal. Then Samuel went to Saul, and Saul said to him, blessed are you of the Lord, I have performed the commandments of the Lord. And Samuel said, what then is this I'm hearing? The instruction you received was to kill all. Why am I hearing the lowing of oxen and the bleating of sheep? And he said, they have brought them from the Amalekite, for the people spare the best of the sheep and oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest you have utterly destroyed. Can you imagine? You were supposed to destroy everything. Why did you save some? He said, it's for sacrifice. And Samuel said to him, be quiet. I will tell you what the Lord said to me last night. And he said, speak on. So Samuel told him, when you were little in your own eyes, many of us, when we come to church, when we come to God, when we give our life to Christ, we are little in our own eyes. When we have a need, we are little in our own eyes. When we join a ministry, we are little in our own eyes. But when we now become leaders, we now think that we have arrived. See what happens. He said, were you not the head of the tribe of Israel? And did not the Lord anoint you king over Israel? He was the one that anointed you. God loves humility. When Saul came to God, he was so humble. But not so. Later, the Bible said, now the Lord sent you on a mission and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners. The Amalekites, fight against them until they are consumed. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and do evil in the sight of the Lord? It was greed that made him. He spared some of them for himself and for his men. And Saul said to Samuel, but I've obeyed the voice of the Lord and gone on the mission of which the Lord sent me and brought back Agag, king of Amalek, and I've utterly destroyed the Amalekite. But the people took of the plunder, sheep and oxen, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. Can you imagine? And Samuel said, as the Lord delights in burnt offering and sacrifice, as in obeying the voice of the Lord, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, the Lord said he has also rejected you from being king. Then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. I have transgressed the commandments of the Lord and your word, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. He feared the people. Are you doing your service in the kingdom to please a pastor, to please your friends, to please the people? Or are you doing it to please God? He said, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. Now, therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may worship the Lord. But Samuel said to Saul, I will not return with you, for you have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you from being king over Israel. And as Samuel turned away to go, Saul seized the edge of his robe and he tore. He added error upon error. And so Samuel said to him, the Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to the neighbor of yours, who is better than you. And also the strength of Israel will not lie nor relent, for he is not a man that he should relent. You see the capital letter there is strength. That is the Lord. And he said, I have sinned. Yet honor me now, please, before the elders of my people and before Israel. Return with me that I may worship the Lord your God. So Samuel turned back after Saul, and Saul worshiped the Lord. Then Samuel said, bring Agag, king of the Amalekites, here to me. So Agag came to him cautiously. And Agag said, surely the bitterness of death is past. But Samuel said, as your sword has made women childless, so shall your mother be childless among women. And Samuel hacked Agag in pieces before the Lord in Gilgal. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house at Gibeah of Saul. And Samuel went no more to see Saul until the day of his death. Nevertheless, Samuel mourned for Saul, and the Lord regretted that he has made him king over Israel. Can you imagine? You may need to read it a second time to really understand the context. And like I always encourage people, read it in different translations. Saul thought he could correct Samuel. Samuel gave him a prophetic instruction, but he did it his own way. He thought what was right in his eyes. He was like, how can we kill all of these animals? But do you know the reason why God said they should kill all the animals? Because in the Old Testament, nations like Moab, Ammon, the Canaanite, the Amalekite, the Jebusite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, they practiced idolatry, they practiced demon worship, they practiced bestiality. And some of those animals were already compromised. They were already filled with demons. And Jesus Christ had not yet been glorified. In the New Testament, you can cast out demons in the name of Jesus, because Jesus Christ, was the power that solved that problem. It was the answer to that problem. But in the Old Testament, they didn't have the name of Jesus. So the only way they could destroy something who is demonically infested was to kill that thing, whether it's a woman, whether it's a child, whether it's a dog or a cat or a cow. So that was why God gave instruction in the Old Testament, consume, utterly destroy, because they were filled with demons. Amen. I'm not teaching a class on demonology. We'll do that in our school of deliverance later in the year by the grace of God. All right. So the other one is in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse 16 to 21. This one is about Uzziah. He did the same thing. He did his sacrifice before the priest came. They said, it's not for you, Uzziah, to burn incense to the Lord, but for the priest, the sons of Aaron, who are consecrated to burn incense. So do not break ranks. Please do not break ranks. Saul broke rank. He got in trouble. The glory, the kingdom, the throne was taken away from him. The same thing with Uzziah. Uzziah was a king who, you know, the Bible said in Isaiah chapter 6, he said, the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated upon the throne, and the train of his garment filled the temple. And he said the year that the king Uzziah died was when he saw, because Uzziah had to be removed out of the way. What does Uzziah represent? Stubbornness, represent pride. God hates pride. Go and read this one in your spare time, by the way. Uzziah went to carry the offering because the priests were delaying, and he was not consecrated for that. He was a king, not a priest. He broke rank. He overstepped his boundary. He led into leprosy. And in the land of Israel, when you are leprous, they separate you. He was taken out. He dwelt in an isolated house because he was a leper. He was cut out from the house of the Lord. He couldn't go to worship in the house of the Lord till his death. And so Jotham, his son, replaced him. May you not be replaced in Jesus' name. Please do not overstep boundary. Do not break ranks. Be patient. The Bible said, humble yourself and the Lord will lead you in due time. Examples of keeping ranks in the Bible. The men of David, the Bible said they were of a loyal heart. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 38. All these men of war who could keep ranks, they came to Hebron with a loyal heart to make David king over Israel. And all the rest of Israel were one mind with the King David. Be of one mind. The Bible said, be of one mind. The Bible wants us to operate with unity. Agree with your leader. Even if you don't like what they are doing, pray for them. Amen. Do not be the dissenter. Do not be the one who is creating dissension in the house. Agree with them. The Bible says, as much as it lies with you, live peaceably with them. If you have a peculiar situation on your hand, ask the Lord for help. Amen. Ask for counsel. The Bible says in the multitude of counsel, there is safety. The second example here is the locust. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 27, it said the locusts have no king, yet they advance in ranks. So we must operate in the ranks. Nobody must break ranks. The locusts are an example of maintaining rank. There is no obvious leader, but they keep ranks. Even when the obvious leader is out of town, make sure that you are not vying for, hey, I'm in charge. That's what James and John, the sons of Zebedee, wanted to do. They were fighting with each other. Their mother, they told their mother to talk to Jesus. They were cousins of Jesus, by the way. Their mother was the sister of Mary. And they were like, oh, tell your nephew, tell him to make us leaders because we are family, you know. We should have the lead here. And Jesus Christ said, no, I'm not the one who determines who's going to be on my right or my left. Oh, God. Amen. So this kingdom is not about competition, who must be in charge. Leadership is there for order, is there for somebody to take the charge or to take the lead, because God loves order. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and the ranks, you know, follow the principalities, the power, the thrones, the dominion. He put them in place. And so he wants those things to be in place, but he doesn't want us to be the one kicking against the goats. He doesn't want us to be the one breaking the ranks. You must not operate in rebellion. Why? Because obedience, humility, submission is the nature of Christ. Rebellion, stubbornness, and all of the negative vices is the character of the devil. So what's your choice? The third example of keeping ranks is the end time army described in Joel 2. The Bible said that they run like men of war and they climb the wall. Everyone matching information, non-breaking ranks. Please do not break ranks. Amen. Do not break ranks. Don't say, who is it to tell me what to do? oh, when did he join the church? Yesterday. I remember when I used to lead a team in my church in Chicago, and all the people who were in the team, in the Amoberia team and in the other team, they were ordained ministers. I was titleless. And they were always fighting the pastor. Why will you make her Lord over? Why will you make her the leader of the Amoberia team? And the pastor said, that is the way I want it. Do you understand? And they kicked against it. It was painful. It was not profitable at all. Hallelujah. Bible examples of stewardship and honor. Joshua and Moses. We talked about that yesterday. Joshua was an understudy, an apprentice of Moses. He honored him in every way. He was a standard bearer. And you will see that every encounter that Moses had, Joshua enjoyed the same. And no wonder he succeeded him. In Numbers 27, verse 22, the Bible says, so Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua in the front of everybody and he ordained him. The Bible said that the spirit of wisdom that was upon Moses rested upon Joshua because Moses had laid hands on him. God told him, inaugurate that boy. He has the heart of a servant. He has the heart of a servant. That's the one that I want to lead after. He didn't care about all the other people who could contend. He said, that is the boy. That's my boy. When God is looking at your church, when God is looking at the ministry where you serve, when God is looking around the world, is he going to pick you and say, that's the one I want to lead for me? That's the one. Because God handpicks his leaders. Look at Elijah and Elisha, the same thing. He served his master diligently. At the end of the day, at the end of his apprenticeship, the unction flowed upon him. He even got a double portion of the anointing. You must understand that unction flows in the direction of honor. Always. Unction is attractive to honor. Unction is driven in the direction of honor. You use honor to draw virtue. Look at the woman with the issue of blood. She said, if I can but touch the hem of his garment. She did it intentionally. She did it with intention. And she went to touch the hem of his garment with intention. Are you intentional about the honor you desire? What is the grace upon your pastor you desire? Who is that man of God that you desire the grace upon their life? Do you know you can tap it with honor? I've tapped upon many graces with honor. I'll give you an example. I got a gift yesterday in the mail from one of my spiritual mentors. I'm sure that this is, I've never been to Israel. I desire to go to Israel and I know I will one of these days. I got this prayer mantle from my mentor. Yes, my prophetic mentor. I got it from Israel all the way. I tapped into this relationship. When the mantle came, I put it on myself all night. In the middle of the night, I was tapping into the same grace. That is what it can do. Money cannot buy this. Amen. You tap into it with honor. The anointing flows easily into the life of the person. It flows easily without restraint. I'm telling you the truth. Go and look at all the relationships in the Bible that graces flowed. Honor was involved. Honor that mantle. Honor that anointing. You are not worshiping them. I don't worship men, but I honor leaders. I honor those whose grace God has put over my life. I honor them in cash and in kind. I always tell you, when my parents were alive, I don't know if any of my siblings are listening, and I do not mean any disrespect. My parents blessed me from the bottom of their hearts because I honored them. I was a blessing to them. I'm the kind of person that when they see my alert, they just start praising and praying for me. The same thing with my spiritual parents. Even I make the children of my spiritual parents jealous. They're like, is it only mommy that you know? I'll be like, sorry. You know, they enjoy the blessings too, but most especially, those whom you love, you honor them. Jesus Christ, the Bible said, in fact, John 3:16, our most popular scripture of all time, for God so loved the world that he gave. And the same thing, he said, if I'm your father, in the book of Malachi chapter 1, verse 6, if I'm your father, where is my honor? If I'm your master, where is my fear? If you honor someone, it will show. Hey, and you know what? The anointing will rub off on you. He said, iron sharpens iron, Proverbs 27, verse 17 to 19. Many of us quote this scripture for contemporary relationship. What about relationship that goes up? Horizontal relationship. Horizontal relationship. What about vertical relationship? If you want the unction to flow, the oil to flow on you, then you must honor the oil on the head. It flows to the bed easily. It flows. When you honor the oil on the head, it flows to the bed and then to the skirt of the garment. You must understand that unction flows in the direction of honor. Look at that woman with the issue of blood. Look at the widow of Zarephath. The man of God said, go and bring the last. How many of us can give our last money in our account? I remember a time when we were going through and we had a dire need. And I prayed, and the Lord instructed me, send the last amount of money in your account to your mentor. I did. It released a blessing. Within 6 weeks, there was a turnaround in our family. A turnaround. The kind of trouble that we could not even tell our, our family members. Amen. If you desire to inherit a mantle, then honor that mantle. Honor the mantle. Elisha did it. The Bible said, iron sharpens iron. So a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. He said, whoever keeps a fig tree will eat the fruit. Whoever waits on his master, whoever honors his master will be honored. Are you waiting on your master? Or are you doing it grudgingly? Are you bidding time? And I say, let them finish so that we will do the ordination next day. And then when they ordain you, and you become too hot to handle. When they make you leader, you become their enemy. Praise the Lord. He said, as in water faces heart to face, so the heart of a man to another. Look at it play out in the life of Peter. Peter followed Jesus everywhere. He received his mantle. He told him, upon this rock I'll build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail. He directly and indirectly, he handed off the mantle to him. You know, Matthew 10:41, I've said it earlier. I said, he will receive the prophet in the name of a prophet. He will receive a prophet's reward. How will prophetic unction not flow to me when I understand it? I understand it greatly. I treasure relationships. I see somebody carry a grace. I honor it. I became intentional a few years ago. I started to treasure it. I don't treat relationships anyhow. Surely those people pray for me. The prayer gets answered. And when I see it in their life, I see something happen in my own life too. I place value on it. Whether it is a higher relationship, a senior relationship, a contemporary relationship, or a subordinate relationship. And when you say subordinate, in fact, that's when you should even keep it, you should make it even more precious, because the Bible is saying we shouldn't lord it over those, we should even serve them. That's the way to operate with balance, authority, and submission, as unto the Lord. In order to please God with your kingdom service, you must grow in, and to grow in spiritual influence, you must grow in humility. Humility is required. I've heard Pastor Reverend Mrs. Funke Felix Adichimo said, you may be age mates, but you are not grace mates. There are some people I'm even older than them. I will honor them. There's a way that grace will flow to me from them, just because, let me tell you, this matter of anointing is not about age. God saw the old man there when he made Joshua the leader. God saw the old man there when he anointed David. God saw the old man there when he... All the other sons of the prophet, they were angry with Elisha. Elisha, that was a stranger, they teach by it. God saw all of these people when he decided to pick those he will pick. What is the criteria for leadership before God? What is the criteria for promotion? Let's quickly look at it in James 4, and then we can close. James 4 and 1 Peter 5. He said, God, James 4, 6, he said, therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. Do you see it here? He gives grace to the humble. He resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. He said, therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil. Why? Because the devil is the father of pride, rebellion. He's the one that is the one is in charge of stubbornness. So when you are seeing all of these things coming in your heart, rebellion, stubbornness, disloyalty, check your heart. Consider your ways. He said, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Draw near to God and will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinner. Purify your heart with double-minded. Are you operating with your master with a double mind? Are you always seconding what they do? Are you always suspicious of their intention? I don't even know what they are doing now. Don't be that. Heaven is watching. Heaven is keeping record. One day you'll be a leader too. May it not be difficult for you. I told you I had a few people I was leading in Chicago. It was difficult to lead those people. In fact, when I left, I was so happy. I was glad. I've also had a few situations in the Nehemiah troop. Nehemiah troop started 10 years ago, to the glory of God. Some people who started with us, they're still here on the line. Some people, very difficult to lead. I've shared time and again. I always pray them, be like, Lord, just let this person say they don't want to do anymore. Because it resists prayer, it impedes the anointing, it does not create a good atmosphere. It does not. then nothing. The Bible said, be one-minded, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, unity of faith, edification of the body. The edification comes when there's unity. He said, how good and how blessed it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. Be of one life, be of one mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ. Even though he was the Lord of all, he submitted himself even to the death of the cross. And because of this, wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name higher than every other name. At the name of Jesus, every name is power. Why don't you be that leader who submits? Why don't you be that leader who every member of their department wants to work with them? They're like, ah, I love you. It's such a pleasure to work with him. It's so pleasant to work with him. And even if you have a tough boss, a tough employer, a tough HOD, a tough pastor, be the intercessor there. Let heaven be the one commending you and urging you. Say, good, that's my boy. That's my boy. He's the next in line. He's the next in line for promotion. Do you know that when Joshua was even defending Moses one day, when he was anointing the elders, I believe is in Numbers 11, when he delegated authority and ordained the 70 elders of Israel. Elder and Midah did not obey him. They stayed in the camp. And the Bible said when the Spirit of God descended, because God had picked those 70 elders, by the way, by the mouth of Moses. They didn't believe in Moses. They're like, who is he to tell us what to do? And when he prayed, do you know that everybody started prophesying, including the two ones who were disobedient, because Moses had submitted their name in the tabernacle of meeting, and the anointing fell on them. And Joshua said, should I go and shut them up? They are prophesying. He said, leave them. I wish all of you were prophets. He told them, don't defend me. You don't need to defend yourself. God knows how to defend his own. And that's why it's very dangerous for us to be rebellious against God's delegated or ordained authority. 1 Peter 5:5 says, submit to God, resist the devil. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourself to the elders. Why is it difficult for us to respect the elders? Why is it difficult? It does not take, in fact, it brings honor. I found that it brings, the more I honor people, the more, I've never seen somebody you honor and they will walk all over you. The Bible said a man who is in honor and does not understand is like a beast that perishes. If you honor someone, they dishonor you. Just excuse yourself and walk away. Don't react in pride. God has a way of defending you. He has a way of defending his own. You do not change your character because people are bad or they walk over. I've seen other ministers, other co-ministers that I honor, and they think that you are not very smart. It's okay. It's okay. Time proves all things. The result speaks. Amen. He said, all of you, be submissive to one another. Be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. I don't care what leadership role I take. I don't care what leadership, what accolade of men. I don't care what title. I don't want God to resist me. I need my prayers answered. I need his presence in my life. I need this unction. I need this power to trample upon serpent and scorpion. The family I come from is hot. I need fire. I need fire so I can't allow God to resist me. I can't afford it. Some people can't afford it. They don't have witches in their own village. But in my own case, I need that covering. So I must continue to humble myself. It does not cost me anything. Amen. So the conclusion of the matter is, the Bible teaches us that we should submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, but not doing naught to man. We should esteem others better than ourselves, obey those who have authority over us, and most of all, to submit to God's authority. We have come to the end of today's class. Let's pray, and then we're going to have our time of Q&A. I believe we're going to enjoy that one. Please remember to join us for tomorrow's crossover. We're going to be crossing over to a new month. Don't forget that, just in case, because of church, you are not able to join this class. So I just needed to say that before we pray. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We give you praise for time in your presence. We thank you for the privilege to learn. We thank you for the privilege to know more. We thank you for the privilege to understand authority and submission and kingdom stewardship. We give you praise, oh God. Father, Lord, be exalted. Be exalted, oh God. Father, we are praying, oh Lord, Father, that this word will stay with us. We pray that you will help us, oh Lord, Father, to grow in humility. And that, Lord, that we will decrease, that you will increase. That your glory will shine forth in our lives in Jesus' name. And we pray that our work teams in church, our work teams in ministry, our work teams, oh God, in our place of our employment, we get better in the name of Jesus. We receive wisdom today, O Lord Father, even to manage, O Lord Father, servant leadership in the secular, in the name of Jesus. In our homes, O God, authority and submission will be apparent, O Lord Father. Your constituted authority will rise. The leadership in our homes will rise. Godly leadership will shine, Father, Lord, in our families, among our children, in our extended family, and Father, especially in the church. And Lord, we pray that, Lord, this lesson will stay with us and it will transform us and we will teach it to others also. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 So I'm going to stop the recording. Stop. I will stop it here as well, and I will unmute everyone so that we can all enjoy a session of discussion.